I met my husband through an introduction. My aunt introduced me to my husband. My aunt lived in Vienna, had a very big department store. My husband lived in Paris. This gentleman was a buyer in furs in Paris for her department store. So she knew the family and very well, and this young man. And sure enough, one day a lady called my parents and she said, I am the mother of Mr. then Weizenbaum. We changed our name then later on in America. And she said, I'm here and I bring, I know your sister. She said, my mother, I know your sister. And I would like to meet you. She wanted to see me first, how I looked, because my husband was, her son was very particular. And he didn't want a girl who should be too tall or too short and too heavy, you know, and she had to be attractive. I was 17 years old. We were traditional Jewish people. My parents didn't want that I should meet somebody that they don't agree to. So it was very common at that time that parents arrange for the marriage of their children, especially for their daughters. A few weeks later, this gentleman came and we had a date with him, you know, my parents, my aunt, his mother, and I. And I was not very happy about it. Not very happy, because in my age we all had boyfriends and girlfriends and we went skiing and skating and we didn't think of getting married. But anyhow, I met this gentleman and he was 15 years older than I was, and in my eyes he was already a mature gentleman. I wasn't used to mix with these with men in this age. We met in the 5 o'clock tea in a very nice hotel, and he was very elegant, and I never went out with such an elegant man. My boyfriends were all schoolboys with, at that time, you know, very not informally dressed. And so anyhow, I was impressed. He also was a good dancer, and we had a very nice afternoon. And so we knew each other for 3 days, actually. We went out every day, you know. One day he invited me to the theater and things. So after the third day, he said to me, I would like to marry you. And I said, I just met you. He said, listen, I would like to talk to your father. So anyhow, I wanted to prepare my parents. So I come home from a date, from the third day, and I said to my mother, what would you say if I will tell you that I will be maybe engaged this coming week? So my mother said, you are completely nuts. I said, why am I nuts? You introduced me to this man. And this was your idea and you wanted I should get married. I like him. Apparently he likes me and he proposed to me. And my mother got mad. What do you think? The first one, we introduced to you. You have to, do you marry him? No, absolutely not. He was very upset. He said, listen, I like you. You like me? I said, yes. And actually, you know, at 17, I really didn't know, do I like him? Do I don't like him? I liked him, but I didn't know the feeling. How do you have to like somebody in order to get married to? So, but I was absolutely, you know, very impressed that he lived in Paris, and I have never been away from Vienna, not more than 50 miles. He said, promise me one thing, I will talk to your father, but even if they say no, that you come with me to Paris. And I said, yes. And he came to my parents a few days later, to my father, and proposed. And my father, you know, at that time he said, listen, will you be able to support my daughter, you know? I mean, they were not against it, you know, because the family background was the same. Okay. So My father agreed. We got engaged, and the engagement party was in my aunt, Mrs. Krupnik. She had a beautiful estate about 75 miles away from Vienna, a second home, a country home. And being it was May, end of May, so the engagement party was there, the whole family, you know, it was a beautiful garden party. And then my husband left, my fiancé left with his mother back to Paris. And he said, listen, and my parents decided with his mother that the wedding should be by the end of the year, possibly the first, in January, the first week in January, because as my husband was at that time in the fur line, it was the season there, and he couldn't get away from Vienna. At that time you took a train and it was 24 hours from Paris to Vienna, you know. You didn't take a plane, but now in an hour and a half you are from one country to the other one. My mother-in-law invited me to her house and I spent a beautiful 4 weeks in Paris. For my part, I didn't even want to come back, you know. I wouldn't have mind, you know. But every girl likes a wedding, and we were a very big family, you know, and the big wedding was planned. So anyhow, I had the feeling of Paris, which I adored. I liked it, and it was just beautiful. And it was a beautiful wedding, you can imagine. Very, very beautiful. My husband wanted to show me a beautiful honeymoon. So we went to Monte Carlo first, and he wanted to show me the casino, and they didn't let me in the casino because they said, you cannot, teenage, she's a child. How old are you? I said, 17, going on 18. Where's your passport? I still had my passport on my maiden name. So he said, I'm sorry, I cannot let you in. Under 18, you are not allowed. So my husband said, we are married. Show him your wedding band. I show him wedding band. He said, well, everybody can be married. Everybody can show me a wedding band. But anyhow, so finally he let me in. You know, it was very funny. So we were 2 weeks on the Riviera. And then we went to Paris. My apartment wasn't ready yet. It was still painted, you know. It was not painted like here in America where you paint it in 3 days. We had like two-bedroom apartments, so four rooms, you know. It was big. And so my husband engaged a painter. And he painted like he thought he's... He's Michelangelo, you know, like this. He was from Russian descent, and he thought, said it took 2 months till he painted it. But I never painted again, and I lived almost 10 years in Paris. It was so well painted. After the first few weeks, I would say, I was very curious. I was running around in Paris, and my husband never knew where I was. You know, he could never find me. I wanted to see everything. So after a while he said, listen, I don't like you to run around, you know. I have to know where you are, because I began to learn French, you know. And he said, it makes me nervous, you know, I don't like that. Why don't you come into business and help me? And that's what I did, you know, and I loved it. I really loved it, you know, because he was a wholesaler. And we had customers from all over the world. You know, and it was interesting. I liked it. And then after 3 months of being married, I met my very good friend Nora Milchior, you know. And then I had this other friend, Friedel Fleiss, at the same time. Her husband was in the fur line, and our husbands knew each other. And then that's how I know her. So we were actually... and another couple. So we were four couples. We were always together, always. And the men were, you know, good friends. And they all had already babies, and I was already 2 years married, and I didn't have a child, you know. After a while, after being 2 years married, my first child came. It was Susie, Danny's mother. Life was always beautiful. In summer we went away for the whole summer. My husband sent me away, you know, and into Quai Paris-Plage, that's 2 hours from Paris, you know, on the English Channel. And he came every weekend, and it was very, very lovely. '38, when Hitler came to, you know, to Vienna, life wasn't so pleasant anymore because I couldn't live for myself anymore. I had to live for my family. I had to save them all, you know. So I've saved first my 2 brothers because they were in the age of, they were 18 years old at that time, and it was dangerous for them. So we brought them out, you know, and we sent them to Cuba. So we knew people through other people who brought them over illegally. This woman who did that, she was from the underground, like it's all over, you know. She that was a business. And so I don't remember anymore how much we paid, but about, let's say, $500, you understand? Like that, probably it was. I didn't get anything, just her word that she will bring my parents out. So I called up my parents and they should come to the border of Switzerland because they didn't get, as a Jew, you didn't get the permission to go out. My parents came to Basel. At the entrance, you know, at the exit from Austria, you understand? Mm-hmm. And she met them there. But she was a Swiss citizen. She was, and she brought my parents to the French border, you understand? And she brought them over illegally. She knew all the ways to the French border, and then I picked them up on the other side. Once they were in France, they got the permission to stay as political refugees, you know. The war broke out, you know, in France. And everybody, we were afraid too, being as Jewish people. And we didn't know where to go. We tried to get Cuban visas. That were one of the few visas we could buy. And we got the visas for ourselves. Susie was at that time, she was 3 years old. Before we went out to Cuba, we were still in Paris, you know, and France was divided. And we had to go to the free zone. And that was very difficult because we didn't get permission to go, you know. You couldn't move. A Jew was there. You couldn't do anything. So anyhow, we also hired a guide. So you know, from one person, everybody did the same thing, and everything was clandestine, but we all knew about it, you understand? I had this beautiful apartment, this beautiful thing, whatever I had to leave, you know. But I took my silver along, you know, and we shipped it on the free zone, you know. And it was very dangerous, especially for the superintendent in the house, la concierge, you know, because we didn't know, was she was she a Nazi or was she underground, you know, because many were not friendly, you know, towards us. But she was good. We just happened to be lucky. She didn't say one word, you know. And so we left as we would go with a little handbag, as we would go someplace visiting somebody. And we went with this guide at night over the border to the unoccupied zone. And my parents at that time were in Limoges, which was the unoccupied zone. And we went to say goodbye to them, and I promised my mother that we will, as soon as possible, we will try to, you know, take them out. So we went to Marseille, which was also the free zone, and my husband's mother was very sick there, and she passed away. When we left Paris for Bordeaux, you know, we had our visas. What was one? It was not occupied. We also sent, you asked me before if we had money. We sent about 6 big cases of furs, because we were dealers, you know, to Bordeaux in order to be sent to America. What we did not know is that in the meantime, Bordeaux was occupied by the Germans. And all the docks, the merchandise were occupied. We did not know that. But we had to go. We went there because my mother-in-law passed away. And in the meantime, we got, we called up Bordeaux for what's happening to our merchandise, you know. So they said, we cannot tell you anything, but the docks are all occupied. But these were French people. They were occupied as a whole by the Germans. But all the French people were still there, you understand? So what my husband was sitting shiva, you know, for his mother. And I was very courageous, I would say. And I was looking, I didn't look Jewish, you know, I had blonde hair, blue eyes. And I wasn't the type. He said, Leo said, you know, would you want to go in the occupied zone and see what's going on? I said, yes, I go. And we found out how to go. The underground was very big in Marseille. Very, very big. Every second one. Every sign was another sign, you know, and we were told. And there was a lady, she said she will go with me. She will bring me, and she will bring me back. She will go with me there, and to the wherever. As anyhow, she goes with me, and at the demarcation line, the train stops, and then the German come in, you know, in Bordeaux, and she was arrested. And she made me a sign not to worry. She said, go to Hotel Seven Frères. The Seventh Frère, and I will be there. So I come to Bordeaux, and I take a taxi, and I go to the Hotel the Seventh Frère. But she, I don't know, did she know that the hotel was occupied, but there was a big flag with the, you know, with the Nazi Ensign Hakenkreuz. So I didn't know, should I go in, I had no valises, I had just a little, nothing, you know, a little bigger than a handbag. I didn't know that I had to stay there. So I go up and down as a man comes out, a Frenchman. He said, Mademoiselle, est-ce que vous cherchez quelqu'un? I didn't know, I did not, but I have a rendezvous ici avec quelqu'un. Ah bon, alors venez, vous voulez dormir ici? I said, no, but that I, maybe not, if I will see, if that person doesn't, if my friend doesn't come, maybe I will stay overnight. Sure enough, he says, you stay overnight, goes into the office, and maybe she got already with him in touch, you know, I didn't know anything. He said, you stay overnight, I give you a room, I have a room upstairs, you know. As I'm going, he's giving me the room, he's coming up with me, he said, listen, your guide does not come today. She's going back. She was arrested, but she's out. And he knew. he was looking for me. She got already, you know. And she's going back, and she will tell. She's telling your husband that you will stay. So I said, listen, I don't know. Can you get in touch with? I have to go to the Kommandantur tomorrow and to the American Express where our bags are, our merchandise. Can you tell your friend to get in touch with you tomorrow? And I let her know. She should tell my husband that I come back in a day or two. We'll see. He said, yes, don't worry, we'll be. You go tomorrow, you do whatever you have to do, and you will tell me what you, and then we will let your husband know. I go tomorrow. The first thing, I go to the American Express, to the, you know, to the warehouse where they had our merchandise. And they laughed at me. They said, lady, you cannot get out anything from there because they have it. It's theirs. But the only thing what you can do, go to the Kommandantur, you know, to the Germans. And you may tell them. So I go the next day to the Kommandantur. There was a very nice young woman also. And she said, what can I do for you? And I told her, we are on the fur line, and we deal with America, and we send merchandise to America. And now you occupied everything. Who are you? She said, I'm Mrs. So-and-so. And where's your husband? I said, I don't know. The whole country is on the run. I have a little child. She's 3 years old. I left her with my cousin in Marseille because we had to flee. I don't know where everybody is. I have nothing to eat if I don't have the merchandise, you know. I don't know anything. Then she said to me, what would you do with your merchandise? First she said, you are Weizenbaum, but are you born what? I said, I'm born Drucker. Drucker is a very common name, very neutral. And your father? No, I didn't know what to say. My father's name is Israel. And my mother's name is Antonia. I said, Anton Drucker. So she could misunderstood me, right? She said, listen, I want to tell you something. Today is Tuesday. On Friday, we have a hearing for different things. And would you open your store in Paris? I said, yes, sure, of course. Of course I would open my store. And Friday I will put your dossier, your file first. Come on Friday. And we will tell you what's what. I said, I thanked her, she was very nice, and I'll be there Friday. I go back to my hotel room, and I told my friend that I will not be, I have to stay here till Friday. Okay, fine. So in the meantime, I was wandering around the streets of Bordeaux. You only saw carpet to carpet wall of German soldier. It was a terrible atmosphere. Terrible. But it was Friday, and here I see two Jewish people. I couldn't talk to anybody. I went over to them, and they were frightened to death of me. Frightened to death. I said, please, it's Friday evening, Shabbat tonight. Let me come to your house, to your table. I'm here all by myself. I'm not in touch with my husband or my child. And I have to go back to Paris. So finally, they agreed with me and said, listen, come to us tonight. And I was there tonight, you know. And I said, there was a train still at night, you know. But this was late, I have to tell this. I skipped something. So anyhow, I come Friday, and she's congratulated me, the girl at the Kommandantur. And she said, Mrs. Weizenbaum, your merchandise got free, but go immediately and take them out. You never know. In an hour it will change. So I ran back to the American Express and said, listen, how do I get the merchandise out? He said, we have no gasoline, we have no cars, you have to hire a boy and I give you a wagon, and together with that boy and you can push it as much as you can to us from the docks out, and then we ship it to you to Paris. And that's what I did. He gave me a hand wagon, as big as this bag, and a very strong boy. And we went through the streets of Bordeaux till the American Express 6 times, you know. I was exhausted. That's why, you know, that's why I couldn't, I didn't know should I take the train back. And I sent it back to our store. It was closed, naturally, but to Paris. I figured in Paris, I couldn't get anyone in touch with this woman if I leave tonight, you know. I couldn't tell her where I was, what I was doing. I couldn't tell her anything. So I figured out I go to Paris, and it's a big city, and there's a lot of people, you know, I know. And you can, you know, you have more of a communication. So that's what I did. And I went back, these people invited me Friday evening. And I said to this man, you know, there is a night train to Paris. And he said, listen, God helped you. Why should you go on Shabbat? He said, don't do that. Don't do that. And I figured he's right. Why should I really go? There was only one train to Paris, and that was like at 12 o'clock at noon, but I couldn't stand it anymore in this hotel. And I told this man, I said, listen, I go with the train at 12. I cannot stand it here anymore. I'm sitting and waiting on the station at Bordeaux. And that was a good thing what I did, because my husband didn't know where I was. I was no more in contact with that other lady. And he decided to go back to the occupied zone with Susie, which was 3 years old, you know. And he only knew that I was at this Hotel Seven Frères, you understand? And he came to Bordeaux, went to the hotel, and the man said, your wife is sitting at the station and she's taking a train at 12 o'clock. And I was sitting at the station, and from the far I see a man with a child in the arm, and the child says, Mama, Mama, Utie, Utie, Mama, Mama. It was Susie. It was my husband and Susie. Once in Paris, we had a task. My husband said, we sell everything. We got our merchandise, was already waiting for us when we arrived. We opened the store, and we made a sign, you know, that first liquidation. And the Germans, they were tearing out the first from our hand. Any price. We made money. So at the end, it was lucky, you understand? Because that was the many thousand dollars we had sewn into all the, you know, in all the, But anyhow, you know, the guide who was going with us took Susie first, you know. And he said, listen, if something happens to you, you know, I'm on the other side, at least your child, and I will somehow I'll bring it to you, to your parents or something. My parents at that time were still in Limoges. But he was very good, you know. He said, we had to cross a big street, like a highway, you know, which was the demarcation land. And he said, listen, I light a cigarette. If I hold a cigarette like that, that you should duck, you should hide. I can always go, you know, because I live on the other side. And he did that once. And I told, I had all my jewelry with me, the beautiful jewelry. And I said to my husband, I'll throw the jewelry away. He said, don't throw away. Listen. And I didn't throw away, thanks God. But thanks goodness, you know, the patrol went on bicycles. And when they were off, he made us a sign, and we were running over the highway, you know. But we could do all this. We were so very young, you know. And when you're so young, you don't even capture the terrible danger you are in. But anyhow, we went to Cuba. We had visas, you know. We went to Cuba. And we thought we are going on a luxury boat. And my husband said, because we went through so much, he said, you know, you buy yourself a beautiful evening gown because we have first class to go on that boat and we'll have a good time. The boat, we had to embark from Cadiz, Spain. So we had to go to Spain by train. And we had to wait. We waited every day to go on the ship, and every day they said something else. The ship has to be repaired, and this is finally we stood 4 weeks in Cadiz. Can you imagine 4 weeks? And finally came the day where we could go on the ship. And they told us to come on the ship in the evening. We came on the ship, it was pitch dark. There was no light. It was a freighter. So, you know, we were fooled. At that time we paid $600 a ship ticket, which was would like be today like $2,500 or $3,000. So we came on the ship, men were separated and women were separated. There were no beds, nothing. We were only like wooden benches, you know, and one above the other one. And Susie was 3 years, I had to share a bench with her. And the men were separated. The ship began to sail, and everybody said, there is some dining room, dining space downstairs in the ship, we should go all down, in shift, you know, in family. So my husband said, okay, let's go down. The first two steps, a terrible odor came up, but awful, you know, from rotten meat or something like that. So my husband said, listen, we are not eating. We are not doing. We are supposed to come in the morning to Portugal. And we did. And in Portugal we will buy, you know, bread and sardines and things we are not eating. People which ate became very sick. 7 people died on typhoid. It was typhoid on the boat, you know. The sanitary condition were absolutely impossible. Terrible, I cannot tell you. But we were very, my husband was very careful. He said, we will just eat bread till we arrive in Cuba. It was 2.5 weeks at that time. It was a freighter, mm-hmm. Can you imagine? So we were lucky that we were most of the times up on the deck. We were sleeping up on, this was summer, you know, we were sleeping, I didn't want to go down. It was terrible, you know, rats. It was just awful, I cannot tell you. We didn't have passports. We had soft conduits, you know, which we obtained in the free zone of France. It's just a piece of paper which I have still today, which I will give to my daughter as a soft card. It's an antique. She should have that, you know, to see. It's a piece of paper with my photo and Susie on it, and my name, and that no nationality. We renounced Austrian nationality. And that's it. We are just our name, where we are born, where we were born, and this is it. Sans nationalité. And we came to Cuba like that, and we were interned 1 week because there was typhoid on the ship, you know. They didn't let us on the land. Yes, good. And but we were in good shape, you know. And my husband and I, we had a fight because we had our visas already. We had our affidavits to go to Paris, to New York, because my brother-in-law, Arnold and Susie, my sister-in-law, they were already 5 years prior to our arrival in America. So my husband said, we are going right away. No, I said, I want to go to America right away. I don't want to know anything anymore. Don't, not even from Cuba. He said, it's so beautiful here. Let's stay at least. I said, okay, one week. He said, no, we stay 4 weeks. It's so lovely here. And we went through a lot, you know. Our nerves were shot. So finally, no one was right. He wasn't right and I wasn't right. Because when we arrived, after a few weeks, Pearl Harbor broke out. And all the quotas and visas were cancelled, not directly cancelled, but closed. Mm-hmm. But life was very good in Cuba. You know? So we rented a little villa, and Susie was, and I became pregnant, because my husband said, if we come out in good health from Europe, we will have another child, and I agreed. So I was pregnant with Alice. And from the 4 weeks, or from the four, or 1 week became 4 years that we remained in Cuba, till the war was actually out. Had some money in America, you know, we had some money. So we didn't need much. With $500 a month, you lived like a king, you know. So that was good. And then when the war was over, right away we were on the preferred quota, you know, because we had our visa and everything, but it was closed because we were considered enemy aliens, because my husband was born in Vienna and I was born in Vienna. So we were enemy aliens. And when we came to America in January 10th, 1946. And my sister-in-law Susie and my cousin Zitterlax came to the station to meet us, because Alice was 3 years old and Susie was 5.5 years old. And we came right away into my apartment, 250 West 91st Street. I was lucky because Susie and Zitter prepared this apartment for us. It was a good begin, and then Arnold had a big business already. He took in the brothers. My parents, you see, I didn't know where they were. So we searched them through the Red Cross. And my mother was hidden, my mother was very smart. She was hidden in a farm near Limoges. She lived in Limoges, you know. And she was a strong, healthy woman. And my father was rather frail. But she said, listen, she went on this farm and they needed people, you know. And she told this farmer's wife, I can do everything. She really could do it. She was a fantastic cook. She was very handy in sewing. And she could work on the field, you know. And that's what she did. And that saved their lives. My brother Ernest was in the army. He was fighting under General Patton. He was drafted, naturally, and he was in the intelligence service. And he was the third day when Patton invaded the Normandy, he was on the Normandy. And he had only one desire. Where are the parents? I want to see my parents. He didn't know whether he will be alive or not. He was fighting in the biggest fight. But anyhow, it was he came to Limoges, you know. And he knew that my parents were in Limoges then, but he didn't know where, you know. But finally, he found out, I don't know how, but he found out. And he sent one of his aide to my place. He didn't want to knock on the door, here I am, you know, yeah. You can get a terrible shock. And that's how he tells me his story, that he sent one of his aide up to knock on the door of my parents and say, listen, your son is in the vicinity, he will come tonight to see you, that they shouldn't, he's in the army, you know, right. They shouldn't have such a shock. And naturally they had a shock, but they were so happy that someone came. And he filled up his jeep with conserves and food. You know, there was nothing to eat there, you know. And he came like that to my parents, you know. So that is the story. And then we arrived safely in Cuba. And we had 4 years, very good years. I cannot complain, at all. And then in America too, you see, we raised beautiful children, gorgeous grandchildren, have now a beautiful, very lovely new granddaughter, 3 great-grandchildren. My mother lived till the age of 92, a full life here. So I have to be very grateful and thankful to God. And I hope you all will have a very happy life, always. And God should be always and guide you like he guided us. I really wish it to you. And that's all. I love you all.